And let me stress that this isn't supposed to be a fix for the story we got, because you fix a story in the same way that you fix a car. When it's a small crash or only one or two parts need to be replaced, you replace them. With the Star Wars sequels, it's... You know when a car is so completely totaled that there's no point fixing it and you might as well just get a new one? That's what the sequels are. So this is a complete rewrite, but I will be making an active effort to carry over some of the characters and whatnot. So I thought instead of me just listing off all the plot points, I thought it would be fun for me to do a sort of dramatic outline where I'll flesh out several plots and key scenes but summarise some others. So sit back, kick up your feet, and I hope you enjoy it. So first off, let's set up the scene. In the opening title crawl, it says that a war is waging between the First Order and the New Republic. In this new story, Kylo has the same role that he does in the originals. He is the apprentice of the leader of the First Order, but instead of the First Order leader being Snoke, that role is taken by a woman we'll call Darth Khan, the Empress of the First Order, and she is pure evil, like no ifs or buts about it. She is not a morally complex villain, she is just a tyrant who rules with fear, like your proper evil Sith Lord. She'll speak like a kindly smiling mother offering sympathy one moment, then flay you around with her mind the next. When the Empire was crumbling after the Emperor's death, this woman, this Darth Khan, came out of the woodworks and held the Empire's last fragments together under all the infighting, and she reforged it all into the First Order, and under her leadership over these past two decades, the First Order has been steadily growing in strength. And now the political tension is at a boiling point as a fierce, brutal war is being waged between the New Republic and the First Order. But I know what you might be thinking, what's the twist? Like, how is this new story taking the Star Wars formula in a new direction? Well, hold on for a moment, because we'll get there soon enough. So after the first credits roll, we pan down to see the opening shot, a grand space battle between the Republic and the First Order around a red giant sun. We see it through the eyes of Poe, as he isn't a rebel fighter in this, he is a Republic star pilot, and his squadron are flying circles around the TIE fighters, and they're almost single-handedly winning the battle. We establish right at the start that Poe squad are all incredible pilots. Then Kylo, who's been observing the battle in his bridge, gets into his fighter and he just obliterates them. One by one, Kylo alone takes out these ace pilots until it's just Poe left, all the while the epic space battle is still raging on in the background. One thing we show is that even though Kylo steamrolled the other rebels who were all really good pilots, Poe is giving him a real run for his money. Like, we have something in this opening scene that we've never actually seen before in a Star Wars film, a dogfight between two of the galaxy's best pilots. There are a ton of twists and turns, as they're not just flying around aimlessly, but they're doing incredibly complex maneuvers that we've never seen before. Kylo is closing in behind Poe to finish the kill, when Poe spins his craft around and, while flying backwards, shoots at Kylo, forcing him to break off, and then a split second left before Poe's rear crashes into a starship's hull. He recovers control of the ship and flies through a tight space, and goes to re-engage Kylo. Instead of just being told that Poe is a good pilot where people scream, "That's one hell of a pilot!" We see that while every other pilot just gets steamrolled, Poe is actually keeping up with this Sith Lord Kylo in this intense fight between the two. And as Kylo and Poe charge towards each other, their thumbs on the triggers as they ready to open up and see who's the best once and for all, the hot crimson light from the nearby red giant suddenly stops. A shadow is cast over them both, and both Kylo and Poe look up to see the red sun be eclipsed by a ship of terrifying size. It hovers there for a moment, then blasts out a great green pulse, and every ship dies. Every thruster stops, every light in the cockpit goes off, and in one instant, the raging battle comes to a complete standstill. But Poe and Kylo's ships are still on a collision course, so they smash into each other and merge into one. They get a close look at each other as their two ships are now effectively one, and this lump of metal, slowly but surely, falls into the gravity well of a nearby planet. The two grand navies break up into pieces in the atmosphere because they can't handle the strain, and the last shot we see is Kylo and Poe, their fighters burning up upon re-entry. That's the first scene. And then we fade to a calmer shot, showing a sea gently lapping at a beach. Then children wearing Jedi clothes studying, and as one continuous shot, we pan up to show Luke, looking at his students and his Jedi temple, pride on his face. He then looks at an ancient book in his hands, written in a language language that we can't read. But inside of it, one thing we do see pretty clearly is a diagram of a giant stone door, parting to reveal a pure blue light. The temple's a modest place in the middle of nowhere. See, here's the problem. When Darth Sidious came to power, he rewrote the history books. Like, sure, the Empire's gone now, and sure, before Order 66, the Jedi were a force for good in the galaxy, and yes, Palpatine's dead, no resurrections this time, but Palpatine did such a good job at slandering the Jedi name and erasing any record of their good deeds that people don't remember them as these peacekeeping noble knights. They remember them as dark, mythical monsters that kidnap children to induct them into their ranks. The New Republic regards the Jedi with superstitious fear, as does the whole galaxy, and even now, the Republic has carried over the Empire's policy of a standing bounty of a few million credits for anyone who kills or captures a Jedi. Because of this, Luke has to keep his Jedi Order a secret. He knows that if the location of his temple ever got out, no end of bounty hunters would come for him and his students. So they all live sequestered away on some quiet planet. We want to continue Luke's story in this sequel trilogy because it's a sequel, and the whole point of a sequel is to continue, well, the story. In the originals, he was struggling to be the student, so now it makes sense that he's struggling to be the mentor. He's learning to teach these kids how to be Jedi Knights, and he's far from perfect at it. He has a few dozen students. Some of them are just kids, some of them teenagers, but two of them are young adults, his older students. One of which we'll call Cal, because I've been playing way too much Jedi Fallen Order lately, and the other is Rey. And we clearly established at the very start that Rey is incredibly strong with the Force. She is talented. Rey and Cal are sparring, but Rey bests him. Then she looks up to Luke for approval, but he just looks at her with a blank face, and with not a hint of pride on it. And we see how much this hurts Rey. She goes from smiling to suddenly feeling really quite depressed. Then Luke walks up, pats Cal on the shoulder and says, "You'll do better next time," and then walks off. In this scene, we establish that Luke is a genuinely supportive mentor. We see him being like Yoda with the kids, imparting wisdom and being a great teacher. With the teenage students, he's again understanding and supportive. In fact, he's being a generally great mentor to everyone. Except Rey. For some reason, he treats her dispassionately. She is constantly seeking his approval, constantly trying to make him proud like every other student makes him proud. But he never is, no matter how well she does. And we end this scene by Luke having an assembly with his students and saying that he's going away for a while. He needs to retrieve something important, the secrets of the Jedi. And he leaves Cal in charge. And while he gives Cal a lot of parting advice and words of encouragement, he doesn't say one word to Rey. Not even a goodbye. So then we go back to Poe. He's still falling into the atmosphere, so he ejects from his fighter and parachutes down in a thick jungle. He quickly meets a stormtrooper with a cracked helmet, and they fight in a desperate battle. Poe nearly grabs his blaster and is just about to kill the stormtrooper when Poe suddenly freezes, then flies up and hovers in the air. Kylo steps out from the tree line with his hand raised. He's restraining Poe with the Force. Kylo quickly identifies him as the pilot he was fighting against, and Poe tenses. He takes in a long breath, readying himself to die. But instead, Kylo reaches out and shakes Poe's hand. Even though Poe is the enemy, Kylo takes the moment to show respect to someone who he regards as an equal, someone who is clearly incredibly skilled in a fighter, even if he's on the other side of the war. Then they cuff Poe and take him as a prisoner. And as I said before, the stormtrooper's helmet's cracked. It took too much damage in the crash, and he asks Kylo if he can remove it because now the HUD's glitching out and it's just more annoying than it is helpful. Kylo gives permission, and he takes it off, and we reveal that it is Finn. In this story, Finn doesn't defect. He's a career stormtrooper, one who's fiercely loyal to the cause, and a member of Kylo's personal army, the 501st, a legion reserved for the best soldiers in the whole of the First Order, and one drenched in bloody history. And what we'll see over the course of these movies is a friendship build between Poe and Finn. Poe is fiercely loyal to the Republic. Finn is fiercely loyal to the First Order. They disagree on so many things. They couldn't be more different as human beings. But as the movies go along, they build a genuine friendship, despite the great big political wedge that's between them. So Kylo pulls up a holomap of his area, and he sees that there are friendly life signs all over the planet. It seems that a seriously large chunk of the First Order's forces survived the battle and made it to the planet's surface. So the three of them then make their way towards the closest life signs. But then, once they're wading through the thick jungle, Kylo brings up the map again to see where he's going, and there are far fewer lights than they were before. Finn says it must be a glitch, or maybe the IFF signals are being jammed. But then they realise that one by one, the lights are snuffing out. Something is hunting and killing the survivors of the battle. And then their march turns into a run. And now we go back to Luke. One thing that I haven't mentioned before in this video, and I kind of regret not doing it before, but one thing that I really hated about the sequel trilogy was how it pretended that the prequels never happened. Like, there's one moment in The Last Jedi where Luke says,
"At the height of their powers, they allowed Darth Sidious to rise, create the Empire, and wipe them out."
And when I saw this in the cinema, like, no joke, I genuinely got chills, because it was acknowledging that the prequels actually existed, which is something that I wasn't expecting. Like, think about it this way, right? Star Wars before has been 6 movies, and this sequel trilogy has basically completely ignored 50% of the main entries in the Star Wars franchise. Doesn't that strike you as a total waste of potential? There could have been some really cool ways of giving references and exploring the world of the prequels, and I thought of a pretty nice one for this. So as a fix, Luke is on a mission to the Jedi Temple on Coruscant. And we see that the Jedi Temple has changed so much since we last saw it. It's now a museum dedicated to the heavily edited history of the Jedi who once lived there. And as Luke walks along as a part of a tour led by a female droid guide, he sees holograms of the Jedi that we saw in the originals. We see Kit Fisto and Master Yoda. But right in the middle of this row of holograms, there's this man with a snarling face and evil eyes. And Luke stops for a moment, curious, and the artificial voice from the display says that this is Mace Windu, the single most evil Jedi to have ever lived, and it lists his horrific crimes and says he's a murderer and all kinds of horrible things, and it says that he tried to murder Palpatine in cold blood in the name of gaining more personal power. It's never explicitly said, but the kind of subtext behind this is that Mace is the only Jedi to have ever bested Palpatine in single combat, and the fact that Mace came so close to killing him and disfigured him pissed Palpatine off so much that he made sure to focus his slander on Mace, to edit his legacy, to show him being the most despicable, evil Jedi to have ever lived, and he did it purely out of spite. So then the tour carries on, and maybe we see a few Easter eggs on displays here and there, and it finally reaches the heart of the museum, and we see this old door, with archaic writings and runes engraved into the stone. The very same door that we saw in that book in the opening shot with Luke. And the droid tour guide says that behind this door is the Jedi Master Holocron Vault. Behind this door is where the Jedi stored their most powerful artifacts and their most dangerous secrets. The door hasn't budged in 50 years. They've never been able to get in with physical force, not for lack of trying. There is some kind of energy about it, and it can only be opened by a Jedi Master. But the guide says the problem is that all the Jedi Masters died decades ago in Order 66, and the secrets to opening this were lost with them. It's quite possible that the vault behind those doors and all of the hidden dark secrets of the Jedi behind it will be lost forever. And then Luke rubs his chin, walks around a corner, the guide goes after him to ask where the hell he's going, but she turns around the corner and there's no one there. The droid seems to glitch out for a moment as her head twitches, and then she says she really must be recalibrated and walks back to the group. Then we fade to night once everyone's gone. Luke jumps down from the rafters where he's been hiding the whole time. He pulls out the book again from his pocket, and while studying it, reverently rubs the door in a specific and complex pattern. For a moment, nothing happens. Then the great stone doors grind like a pestle and mortar. A bright blue light comes through the seam and illuminates Luke in the pitch black. Luke smirks, then steps inside. Luke's come here because he's always known that this Jedi vault existed, and inside is said to be a trove of hidden Jedi knowledge that he would love to have so he can rebuild the Order to its former glory. However, just like everyone else, he's never been able to figure out how to get in, not until he found that book. And as Luke is trawling around with childlike awe on his face as he goes through all of these wonders and artifacts in this perfectly preserved vault from the old Jedi Order, something grabs his eye. There's a holocron cube on a shelf, and it doesn't look sinister, but Luke just senses something about it, a disturbance in the Force. Something about it replaces the awe on his face with terror. So he reaches out and activates it. A hologram appears, showing a middle-aged man with a cape held by a chain. His hair is largely black, with just the hints of grey on the edges, and on his belt is a lightsaber with a curved hilt. He introduces himself as Jedi Master Dooku, and the holocron is his full report on an encounter he had in the Outer Rim. They resurrected Tarkin with CGI, they can totally do that with Count Dooku. And he tells a story, and as he goes into it, we have a full-on flashback to middle-aged Count Dooku, and this takes place 10 years before the prequels even happened. As he tells it, there was a battle between the Republic Navy and a band of pirates who had been raiding nearby settlements, and Dooku was sent there acting as an emissary for the Jedi Council on a peacekeeping mission to protect the locals from the pirates. Scum. But as the battle raged, and he observed it all from a command bridge, he noticed something far, far away. A normal human eye could never see it, but with his heightened Jedi senses, he saw clear as day a speck of dull light from a ship's thruster against the darkness of the stars. Something was watching them. He ordered a full scan be done in its direction, and the scans showed nothing was there. Whatever that craft was, it was so advanced that it had total stealth technology, and Dooku wasn't aware of any craft that had that level of technology. And once the battle was won, the ship vanished in the blink of an eye, and Dooku had the most terrible feeling. He didn't know why, but his hairs stood on their ends, and he knew that whatever that thing was, it was a sign of something dark and terrible beyond understanding. So he went on a mission to hunt it down, and after months of searching, of scouring every nearby system with his Jedi senses, because apparently no other form of detection was good enough, Dooku finally sensed the very same vessel he encountered refueling on an asteroid. So he snuck up, used his lightsaber to gut an entry point into the hull, and once he was on board, he was immediately attacked by monstrous grey-skinned creatures with sharp teeth, soulless eyes, and the nose of a skull. They had incredibly powerful weapons technology, like nothing Dooku had ever seen before. There were only four of them, but they attacked with such speed and ferocity that even he, a Jedi Master in his prime, could barely keep up. By the skin of his teeth, he killed all but one, and as he held the saber to the last creature's throat, it snarled in a harsh, nails-on-chalkboard voice.
Your strength is weak. My people are strong. You can do nothing but die.
Who are your people? Asks Dooku,
and the creature, with what might have been a laugh, wheezes the reply.
The Yu Jian Fong.
The creature presses a button on its wrist, the ship blazes in alert, and Dooku immediately senses that a self-destruct has been activated, and with that, he cuts off the creature's head. Dooku then escapes the craft moments before it can destroy itself, and he postulates that the ship must have been some form of advanced scout. What it was a scout for, he couldn't possibly guess, for it was clearly beyond anything previously encountered by the Jedi, but its purpose was obvious. It was observing the battle, assessing our strategies and technologies. It was gathering intelligence for a force unknown, a force that had to be outside the galaxy itself. And Dooku closes off his report by saying,
"Please forgive me, Master Yoda. I have failed you. I haven't done so since I was a child. I confess myself afraid."
Then Luke hurriedly plays another holocron from the same shelf. We see Mace Windu and Master Yoda walking down a corridor, discussing Dooku's report, and they say that it's beyond troubling. So they've secretly deployed 200 listening probes at the edge of the galaxy, their sensors focused into the galactic void. If they ever detect the so-called Yu Jian Vong, their probes will give them an early warning, and provide valuable time to prepare for what's to come. Then Luke scrambles around the room until he eventually finds the control panel for the old Jedi probes Mace was talking about, with a symbol on the board for each of the 200. And all are flashing red, with an overlay text, "Extragalactic crafts detected. The Yu Jian Vong have arrived." Then we cut back to Kylo, Poe and Finn as they hurry towards the dwindling friendly life signs, and they encounter those same creatures we saw in Dooku's flashback, and they are terrifyingly powerful. And we have a great firefight between Kylo, these stormtroopers, and these creatures. Okay, so for those of you who don't know, the Yuuzhan Vong are a race that already exist in Star Wars, only they were in The Legends, which is the canon that Disney basically retconned out of existence. But they're a race of incredible power, and there was this whole story arc where they invaded the Star Wars galaxy. Now, what's the big twist of this trilogy? In the originals, you have the small powerless good guys fighting the big evil bad guys. In the prequels, it was the reverse of that, with the good guys having all the power and the bad guys scheming to take them down. Well, now, both the good guys and the bad guys are equally as powerful, but they have to work together. Because these invaders are monsters. They're about to kill all life in the galaxy, so the Jedi and the Sith, the Republic and the Empire, they hate each other. Like, my god, they hate each other. They have so much bad blood between them, but if they don't unite under this common threat, they're all as good as dead. Just imagine it. Imagine a purely evil Sith Lord fighting with a Jedi like Luke to attack a base or complete an objective and rescue prisoners. Just think about all of that potential lovely conflict as they disagree on how they should do it and whether they should execute the survivors, as the Jedi and Sith clash and hate each other but they have to work together for the common good. Like, if you're looking for a twist on the Star Wars formula, I think that would be perfect. Not that I'm cocky about my own ideas or anything. And over the course of this trilogy, we see this massive war play out as these impossibly powerful invaders with far more advanced technology invade the galaxy and kill everyone they come across, or worse. And along the way, we come across Han and Leia and Chewie and all of the old cast as they join the fight, and we see how much they've changed over the years. That right there is the main premise for this new trilogy. But at the end of the day, character is just as important as plot. And let's go back to Rey. We're going to flesh her out much more. So throughout the whole first movie, we see Rey being basically like quite depressed. Like, she feels like an outsider with no family and no friends. Even though she's a Jedi student, she looks up at the sky and fantasizes about how one day she's going to go out there and find her real family, find her place in all of this. Luke told her one day that he opened his door to find her as a baby delivered to his doorstep with no note, no anything. She didn't know why she was put there or even who her parents were. But she was strong with the Force, so he took her in as a student. But Rey says she just knows her legacy is one of grandeur. She just knows that her parents were brilliant people and she was put in the Jedi Temple for a reason. She just needs to find out what that reason is. If she can find out the reason why her parents left her in the Jedi Temple, that will be the key to finding her place in life. But as I said earlier, Luke doesn't trust Rey. Like, he clearly has no faith in her as a person. And gradually her angst about this builds up until, just at the start of the second film, Rey snaps. She demands to know why her best is never good enough, why he seemingly hates her even though she's never done anything wrong to him. And at her angry outburst, he gulps with fear, and finally tells her the story about Kylo Ren. He says that Ren used to be a pupil of Luke's, and he was like Rey in so many ways. Like, Luke says, whenever he saw Kylo, he saw the darkness in him, just like there's a darkness in Rey. Except Luke reveals that Kylo Ren is more than just some random Padawan. He is the grandson of the Emperor himself. And Luke accepted him knowing that he was Palpatine's grandson, knowing that he had a heritage of evil, but still the optimistic Luke Skywalker, who he knew at the Return of the Jedi, had total faith in Kylo. Luke nurtured Kylo, taught him everything he knew, and he doesn't say it, but by the way that Luke tells the story, it's clear that Luke loved him, like he was his own son. And it plays out like that fix I suggested earlier in the video. One day when Luke was away on some adventure, Kylo murdered the rest of Luke's students and burnt his temple to the ground. It turns out that Darth Khan, the leader of the First Order, found a way to commune with Kylo from inside the temple walls. And this woman of pure evil corrupted Kylo and led him to the dark side. And sure, Luke is someone of incredible persistence. He has an iron will. He didn't let this tragedy and betrayal destroy him. him. He rebuilt the temple in a new location and took in new students, but the betrayal soured him. Not completely, he is still the same Luke we knew. He's just a little more pessimistic, is a little more reluctant to see the good in people, and after his faith in Kylo was betrayed, how could he ever have faith again? Especially in Rey, especially because every time he sees her, he doesn't just see the same darkness that was in Kylo, he sees a worse version of it. And out of every pupil that Luke has ever had, Rey by far has the greatest darkness inside of them. And so then Rey, shocked, unfeeling, no idea what to think, says, "So why did you take me in? If from the start all you ever saw was evil in me, why didn't you just send me away to live somewhere else?" And Luke doesn't say a thing, but on his face is a look of pure shame, and we get a very strong sense that there's more to this story. Again, going on the Rey we saw in the first film, she is desperate to know her heritage. She believes that knowing why she was sent to the temple will be the key to knowing her place in the world, and she begs at Luke, "Who am I? Who were my parents?" And again, he doesn't say a word. And then Rey firms her lip and says, "There's a war going on. I'm going to join it." And she's something along the lines of, "Wherever my home is, my real home, it's not here." And at the beginning of the second movie, Rey runs away to help in the war effort and fight the Yuuzhan Vong. Sure enough, Rey ends up meeting Kylo Ren, and we see a Jedi and a Sith fighting together back to back against these invading aliens. But here's the kicker. Kylo sees how talented Rey is, and he starts giving her advice. He says her sword form is all wrong. That's not how you use form 3, this is, and he imparts all the wisdom that Luke taught him. Kylo, a Sith Lord, actually shows more faith in Rey than Luke ever did. And she finally feels happier than she's ever felt before in her life, as she feels like she's finally found a mentor who actually cares about who she is as a person. But all the while, she's falling to the dark side. Luke intentionally didn't teach Rey about the dark side, because Luke had some sort of misguided belief that the less she knew about the dark side, the less likely she was to fall to it. But now we see that Luke has failed to be a good mentor because she's not equipped enough to realize that she's fallen to the dark side because she doesn't really know what it is, what the symptoms of it are, and all of that. And what we've got to remember is that this is still Luke's story. He has his own journey, and once he's heard about what's happened to Rey, that she is now essentially Kylo Ren's Padawan, he slumps down, incredibly depressed, knowing that he's failed again, that another student of his has fallen to the dark. He is so miserable here, but then a Force ghost comes along in a brown Jedi robe and with aging ginger hair. He's slightly older than we remember. It's Ewan McGregor's Obi-Wan, and he sits down and gives Luke a talk. All of a sudden, it's like Luke's not a mentor anymore, like he's back to being a student, and he voices his doubts, and Obi-Wan gives him some advice. Obi-Wan seems pained, and with difficulty, he says, "Did I ever tell you about how your father became Darth Vader?" Luke looks at him, confused, enthralled, and Obi-Wan says, "He had a vision. A vision of your mother Padme dying in childbirth, and he became so afraid of her death that he did everything he could to stop it. And your mother died not because of childbirth, but because in Anakin's search for ways to defy the prophecy, he became a monster that she could no longer love. And without the person he used to be, she had no reason left to live. If Anakin had never had those visions, if he had never known the future, that very future would have never happened." As Obi-Wan says this, he's at the brink of tears because recalling those days brings him so much pain. And he finally says, "The prophecy only became true because your father believed that it would." And Luke, shock in his eyes, whispers out, "I failed her." And Obi-Wan somberly nods. And Luke ends the talk finally realizing that he has been a terrible mentor, that he's lost faith in the good in people, and because of his failure, he has forced Rey into the path of falling to the dark side. And now Luke becomes determined to fix it, to go after Rey and support her, to be the mentor that he always should have been, to win her back. And as Luke strides away, determined to right his wrongs, Obi-Wan begins to fade. But before he fully disappears, he says, "And Luke, tell her the truth, the whole truth." So then, later in the second movie, Luke confronts Rey, but it's not easy. She has really grown to resent him, but he apologizes, confesses that he has been a terrible mentor, and Luke finally reveals that he lied to her all along. But he lied to protect her. The truth that her mother is Darth Khan, the single most evil person in the galaxy. He reveals that her mother loved her more than anything, but she was kidnapped by a defecting Imperial officer who wanted to put a spanner in her plans. And this Imperial officer, after kidnapping Rey as a baby, tracked down Luke and gave her to him, and he made Luke promise that he would take care of her. But he reveals that Rey's original purpose in life was to be groomed to be the next Darth Khan, to be her apprentice. And this shakes Rey to her core, because, like we've established before, that she hates Darth Khan. Like, Rey knows the terrible deeds she's done, and we made it a point that Rey just despises that woman, truly regards her as a monster. But now she's turned out to be Rey's mother, the person she's always wanted nothing more than to meet and love. What does Rey do? It's been an established point that the Jedi are viewed as these monsters, but Luke comes along, does incredibly heroic deeds in the war, and convinces people to believe in the Jedi once more, and Luke dies in a heroic sacrifice that proves to the galaxy as a whole that the Jedi are not what Palpatine wanted everyone to think they are. Here's the thing, yes, Luke's died, and it's twisted to look like a hopeful moment as he inspires the galaxy to believe again, but we end the second movie of Rey approaching this Darth Khan, unsure of herself, twiddling her fingers, and unsure of whether she should be ready for a fight or ready to love her, Rey reveals who she is. And Khan immediately drops her lightsaber and crushes Rey in a hug as she condenses every hug a mother might give over a childhood into one. And we end the second film of them both embracing each other, the daughter and mother reunited. And Rey decides to embrace her legacy and join her mother on the dark side. And in the third film is where the war wraps up, and despite the horrific costs, they've defeated the Yuuzhan Vong once and for all. But Rey is really falling to the dark side, like she is inches away from becoming a fully fledged Sith Lord. Her mother loves Rey completely, and together they form a great and terrifying team. And while Darth Khan treats literally everyone else horribly, she treats Rey like the most valuable person in the world, and the love between them is really quite clear. And we see how Kylo Ren has basically been sidelined ever since Rey's come back to Darth Khan, because now Khan has her daughter back. Kylo was essentially always her surrogate heir, but now she's got her daughter back. Why the hell would she need Kylo? So she just waves him away as Khan gives all of her focus and love and attention to Rey. But here's the thing, because now Kylo is distanced from Khan, like now he has independence and no one is looming over him and making decisions for him, Kylo realizes that he hates who he is. All the while, Khan is treating Rey all kinds of crazy Sith powers like Force Lightning and so on. But just before Rey commits her first act of true evil and falls to the dark side completely, she finally learns about her father. Rey's father was the irrelevant Imperial officer that kidnapped her as a baby and gave her to Luke. She learns that Khan captured him after he did it and tortured him, and she put him through the most brutal, agonizing horrors anyone can imagine, and many horrors that nobody can. But after all the most horrible tortures in the galaxy, he never gave in. Because he loved his daughter, and he knew what would happen to her if he said the truth. And she learns that her father, a man who she loves desperately, despite never meeting him, wanted nothing more for her than to defy her legacy, to be the opposite of her evil mother. In fact, he wanted her to do that so much that he was willing to give his life in order for her to have that chance. And this shakes Rey. Like, she begins to realize that legacy shouldn't define who she is, and maybe she should be her own person. And she sees herself, her red lightsaber, her pale face, and she realizes that she has essentially become a carbon copy of her Sith mother. She is not Rey anymore. She is Darth Khan, just a younger version of her. She is the monster that her father gave his life so she might have a chance at not being what she is now. And while this is happening, Kylo is also undergoing his arc, as he's now free of the influence of Darth Khan. And while all this is going on, like Cal, that other older Jedi student, he's died, and in Cal's dying breath, he tells Kylo the location of Luke's new Jedi temple, and says that they have no leader. But instead of going there to capture all the students to convert them into being Sith, he goes there to rescue all of these Padawans before the Yuuzhan Vong can reach them. And once Kylo's hid them all away in a nice, quiet, safe corner of the galaxy and is fully back to the light, he goes on a mission to kill Darth Khan and rid the galaxy of her evil once and for all. And we echo the very end of Return of the Jedi here. Kylo tries to kill her, but Khan is just too powerful, and Kylo gets disarmed and is being electrocuted by Khan. He's about to die, and then Rey makes her choice. She raises her saber to her mother to stand up to her legacy, and we have a final epic fight between Rey and her mother before Darth Khan is killed once and for all. And we end on a note where the First Order has been essentially completely destroyed, and due to Luke's heroic sacrifice and how he's changed people's perception of the Jedi, the Republic has agreed to give the temple back to the students. And with the Republic's blessings, Kylo and Rey move back to the original temple with the rest of Luke's Padawans, with both of them back on the light. We see stewards and Republic soldiers wheeling away and taking down all the museum displays, as the museum is now being repurposed back to being a temple. But now, because the First Order's been destroyed, what's going to happen to Finn? Because he was loyal to their cause, but now they're completely gone, and he's without a job, without a leader, without an army to be a part of. But then Kylo goes up to Finn and offers him a position as being a guard in the new Jedi Temple, and so now Finn and Poe are part of the security team protecting the temple. This is just one spitballing solution, it doesn't have to be exactly this. And on the very final shot of the third film, we see Rey and Kylo mentoring these students and teaching them lessons, when Rey looks up to a ledge and a dozen Force ghosts appear. We see Yoda, and Obi-Wan, and Mace Windu, and Qui-Gon, and Anakin, but right in the middle is Luke, his face finally gleaming with the pride that she always wanted. He nods at Rey, she nods back, and we see the ghosts of the old Jedi Masters looking on with pride at the next generation, at a new golden era of the Jedi about to begin. Then the credits roll.